Okay, so let's start. So the title of my talk is the jumping coefficients of non-Q-Goinsky multiplier ideals. And yeah, first of all, I probably should thank Jolt for inviting me and for giving me the opportunity to give this talk, although he could not come, unfortunately. Yes. So maybe first I recall, just briefly recall theory of multiplier ideals in the smooth case, or actually in Q-Goinstein case. So to set the stage somehow, so if x is a smooth variety, or merely normal and Q-Goinstein, so meaning x is normal and some multiple of kx is of the canonical class is Cartier, and yeah, it should always be a complex variety, so we are working over complex numbers, and then right, so now we pick an effective Q divisor on X, and then we have this pair X, comma D, and we can associate to this pair a multiplier ideal in the following way. So we pick a resolution X prime to X, a log resolution of X D. Okay, and then one defines the multiplier ideal I of X XD to be mu lower star of O X prime of the relative canonical divisor, so KX prime minus mu pullback KX minus mu pullback D, and then you take the round up of this. And this is an ideal sheaf on X, so a coherent ideal sheaf, and it's independent of mu. You can show this, right? And the point from the point why the multiplier ideals are interesting is that you have Nadel vanishing for them. So Nadel vanishing states the following: in this setting, so if L is a Z divisor. So, it should be, basically, it's a line bundle. L is a line bundle, and L minus D is big N F. Then you have the following vanishing in the HI of KX plus L, twisted by this multiplier ideal, vanishes for I larger than zero. Okay. This generalizes Kawamata-Fiebig vanishing, simply because Kawamata-Fiebig tells you if the pair XD is in fact KAT, then KX plus L has vanishing, and if XD is KAT, then this ideal is trivial. You can see this from the definition, basically, that in this case I XD is just OX. So this means we can look at the log canonical threshold. So this is somehow related to Professor Mustata's talk yesterday, saying that, he defined a log canonical threshold, and I recall the definition, but I write it down in a slightly different way, but basically it's the same. So the idea is that somehow you scale D, so you multiply T D by some number T, and when T gets larger, then the philosophy is if T gets larger, the singularities get worse, and the multiplier ideal gets smaller. So the log canonical threshold is then basically defined as the infimum of T such that the pair X T D is not KLT. And by what I said before, so XTD is KLT if and only if the multiplier ideal is trivial. So this is the infimum of all T such that I of XTD is strictly contained in X in OX. Okay. So this is the log analytical threshold, and I mean it can be phrased in terms of multiplier ideas. And so somehow, as Professor Mustard told us yesterday, log analytical threshold is somehow also well understood. And then yesterday he talked about the minimum log discrepancy, which is kind of related but more complicated quantity. And I want to go in a slightly different direction. So also starting from log analytical threshold, I want to generalize it somehow in the following way. So my point is, if I make t larger, then somehow this ideal gets smaller and smaller, and I can look at all the values of t where the ideal really gets smaller, and these are called the jumping numbers or jumping coefficients of this pair xd. Okay, so the definition is xi, so number xi is a jumping number. Jumping number of this pair xd if the following holds. So if I of x psi d is strictly contained in I of x lambda d for all lambda smaller than psi. Okay? So the point is, if you change this coefficient, then the multiplier ideal will always be constant on intervals which look like this. Okay, so close on the left and open on the right, and the boundaries of these intervals are simply the jumping numbers. Okay, and the set of all jumping numbers I denote by uppercase xi. So this is the set of all jumping numbers. Of this pair xi xd. So you see that we define a sequence of numbers essentially, and the log analytical threshold is simply the first one of these. And And then there's a paper by Ein, Lazarsfeld, Smith, and Varolin. From 2004, I think, where they study, those jumping numbers appeared in literature before, but in this paper they first somehow systematically studied these numbers, and somehow they show that they appear in several different contexts. So I'm not going to talk about that, but it's a very, very nice paper. So everybody is encouraged to have a look at that. So, but this is still in the smooth case, so if x is smooth, or at least maybe in Q-Gorenstein. And, what I want to talk about now, as I already said in the title, is some of the non-Q-Gorenstein case. So why would you look at that? So one kind to motivate it is looking at characteristic P situation. So, in this context, they are not, they are this discrete set of rational numbers. So, so basically the point is, in the Q-Gorenstein case, you can just pick one, you pick one resolution of, a log resolution of Xd, and you can calculate everything on this one fixed resolution. And therefore, it's more or less easy to see that they are always rational and discrete. But this is exactly what I'm going to talk about later, because in a non-Q-Gorenstein case, it's not so easy. In the characteristic P analog of multiplier ideals, it's called test ideals. The point with test ideals is, for test ideals, you don't need a resolution and you don't need a Q-Cartier assumption. You just need, basically they're defined in terms of the Frobenius map. So it's a purely algebraic definition. You don't need, you can define it for any singularity, basically. And so there are some theorems due to Let's see, Smith, Hara, Haro Yoshida, and Takagi, in probably increasing order of generality, saying that somehow, if you take something in characteristic zero and you reduce to characteristic p, then for p large enough, the multiplier ideal will exactly reduce to the test ideal. So, I mean, it's not just some kind of analog, but you can really make it into a precise statement. Right, so as I said, in characteristic p, you don't need any Q-Gorenstein assumptions. So, somewhat a natural question to look also in the characteristic zero case to look at. Maybe a definition of multiplier ideals, or to find a theory of multiplier ideals which does not rely on the Q-Gorenstein assumption. Okay, and this theory, such a theory, was developed by Tommaso Defenet and Haken. Chris Haken in 2009. So, theory of multiplier ideals. So without without a Q-Gorenstein assumption. Okay. So they still assume some x is normal at least. Probably you could also do a version without normality even, but for simplicity let's stick to the case x is normal. But we do not assume that kx is qkt or anything. Right, so there's this theory, and then basically the natural question that arises is to study the jumping numbers, like Einlassers-Feld-Smith-Werlein somehow, but in this more general context. And yeah, so maybe I will start with a proposition about some basic properties of the jumping numbers. Yeah, so I mean these are things which really can more or less be proved from the definitions. So very basic properties. Sorry? Yeah, actually I wanted to first give the results and then give the definition, if that's fine. Because the definition somehow, I mean, it takes some time, it's not so easy. Yeah, so we take a pair. And by a pair, I always mean, in this talk, I mean normal variety and Z is in fact any proper closed subscheme. Okay, so Z does not have to be a divisor, just any subscheme. And then, yeah, so the properties, the basic properties first. Very basic property is, but even this needs some proof, is if Z is non-empty, then there are, in fact, jumping numbers, okay? So, yeah, so once I have defined the multiplier ideals, I define the jumping numbers in the same way, but I did not define the multiplier ideal itself yet. Notation is the same, yeah. And the definition I will give you in a few minutes. Okay, so this is first property. Second property is so if you have a jumping number, then so xi is a jumping number, then xi plus 1 is also a jumping number. So xi is for xi of xz. And third property is the set xi satisfies DCC, so descending chain condition, which basically is clear because ideals satisfy ACC. The last property is maybe the most interesting here. So if xi is larger than the dimension of x minus 1, then xi is a jumping number if and only if xi plus 1 is a jumping number. Okay, so in some sense it's periodic, right? So it's starting, there's some finite amount, some finite interval up to the dimension minus 1, where anything can happen, and then after that it becomes the set becomes somehow periodic. And yeah, so that's basically this proposition. And now the really interesting question, which was already asked by Defenet and Haken when they first defined this stuff. So the question is psi of xz, where xz is an arbitrary pair, so is it always a discrete set of rational numbers? Again, the motivation for this question is simply this is true in the Q-Gorenstein case, right? So then it's always this discrete set of subset of Q, and right. So there are two parts of the question: so discreteness and rationality. And so rationality basically fails. So Stefano Ubinati, he was a student of Haken, gave examples where, I mean, quite simple examples actually. So a cone over a smooth surface, examples where there are non-rational jumping numbers. So in his example, the jumping numbers are still algebraic, even algebraic of degree 2. So it's not that bad in some sense. And then you can ask, of course, are there also transcendental jumping numbers, or what's the set of all jumping numbers? But I will not talk about that. I don't have any examples or any statements in this direction. So I will focus on the discreteness part, so whether this set is discrete when you fix a pair. And yeah, so there is a positive answer in some cases. So maybe the first case is if x, so x is KLT in the sense of Defenet and Haken. So this is some kind of generalized notion of KLT without a Q-Gorenstein assumption, and it boils down to saying that there is a divisor on x which makes the pair xd KLT. So if x is KLT in this sense, then discreteness is true. So positive answer to discreteness, I should say, not to rationality. And another case is if x is a projective variety with isolated singularities. So if the singularities are isolated, then it's also discreteness is also true. And one more case is if x is a toric variety. Okay, so all these cases are due to Ubinati. And then there's one more case, which is if x is numerically Q-Gorenstein. So I'm not going to define what this means actually. Just for completeness somehow. So this is due to Buxom, Defenet, Fabre, and Ubinati. Okay. Yeah, I think it's fine because, I mean, if D is just any subscheme, you need to go to a resolution such that the pullback of the ideal sheaf is a Cartier divisor. So that's not a problem. But I think the problem is really the pullback of Kx, because you don't know what this means if Kx is not Q-Cartier. But somehow this is exactly how Defenet and Haken did somehow do set up the definition in the general case. So I come to that in a minute. Okay, so now So we see somehow there are several special cases where discreteness holds, and I would say it's expected, or it's, maybe it's a conjecture, that discreteness always holds, but somehow we are, I mean, nobody's able to prove it. So what I can show is somehow a new special case where discreteness holds. And this is it's the following. So x z a pair, and I need a non Q Gorenstein locus of kx to be finite or zero dimensional. Okay. And then the jumping numbers are discrete. Right, so this is somehow a generalization of the case where of this theorem of Rubinati, where you assume that you are projective with isolated singularities. So first, you don't need projectivity, and I mean your singularities do not need to be isolated, but singularities where kx is two Cartier are also, and they're also fine. They need not be isolated. Right. And another theorem, which somehow more or less, I mean, doesn't follow directly, but it uses this theorem too, is so if x is a threefold. Okay, so I mean, if x is a surface, then the singularities are isolated because you assume normal. So in that case, you are fine. So the next case in terms of dimension would be threefolds. And at least if the threefold is has rational singularities, or slightly more generally, if the locus of non-rational singularities is isolated. Okay, so maybe write like this. Non-rational, so the locus of non-rational singularities of X is isolated, then we also have discreteness for any z. Okay, so we do not assume anything on z, just on x. And somehow in the proof of theorem 3, you use theorem 2 and another ingredient, which leads to the next statement. So if x is any pair, there always exists an open subset such that the codimension of the complement is at least 3. So yeah, that's the point. Here we have 3 and not 2. Otherwise, it would be trivial. And u is independent of z. Okay, so such that the jumping numbers, which somehow occur on this open set u, so on u and z restricted to u, is discrete and rational. So discrete set of rational numbers. Okay, so somehow the bad things only happen in codimension 3. And yeah, that's basically what I can say about this question. And yeah, so now I guess it's about time to give the definition of multiplier ideals in general. So maybe I can continue here. So now I will somehow repeat what Delphine and Haken did in their 2009 paper. Right, so the problem is somehow you do not know how to pull back kx if kx is not Q Cartier. So I mean, you need some kind of notion of pullback for wild devices which are not Q Cartier. So how do you do that? So let's say, so we only need to pull back along, say, proper birational morphisms where both varieties are normal. Okay, so yeah, proper why rational and why is normal, and x is normal anyway, and d is a Weyl divisor on, so with z coefficients, Weyl divisor on x. Okay, and then you define the so-called natural pullback of, so we denote it by f natural d. The natural pullback of d is defined by saying so it's essentially you take Ox of minus d. So I mean you look at this Weyl divisorial sheaf and then you can pull back that, right? So you just pull back the functions inside this sheaf and then you take the reflexive hull. Right, and then you have a Weyl divisorial sheaf on Y, and so this comes from a Weyl divisor, and this Weyl divisor is, at least up to a sign, is this natural pullback. The problem, of course, here is somehow, if D is Q-Cartier, then this does not coincide with the usual notion of pullback. For example, because here you always get some integral divisor, and the pullback of a Q-Cartier divisor might also be really a Q divisor, even if the original divisor is a Z divisor. And it also does not commute with, I mean, it's not functorial, right? If you pull back twice, it's not the same as pulling back along the composition. And so this notion is somehow very, very weird and it's not so well behaved. But that's life somehow. You cannot change this. So once we have this, we can define the relative canonical divisor of f by essentially we want to take ky minus pullback of kx, but now this depends on this number m. Okay, so we have ky minus 1 over m times f natural pullback of m kx. Okay. So this depends on this m, really. So you need to look at all values of m at the same time. How would you do that? So first we will, using this approximation of the canonical divisor in some sense, we will define multiply ideals and then essentially pick the largest one which we can get in this way. So let's see. So xc is a pair, and c is some coefficient. Yeah, so we want to define I of x c times z.
Do we expect that to stabilize when m gets bigger?
No, essentially, I think no. But once we define the ideals, they will stabilize, and this is what we are really interested in. So I mean, you can somehow do a limiting process here. But I don't think the limit will be achieved because it can even be, I mean, the limit can even be irrational. So, unfortunately, no. But it would be nice if it were true, but it's not true. So we take a pair, and we pick some m, or essentially for any natural number m, we do the following. F y to x is a resolution, a log resolution of the subscheme z, and o x of minus m k x. Okay, so what this means is that this Weyl divisorial sheaf, if you pull it back and model out the torsion, you get something invertible, right? So without taking a reflexive hull. So the problem somehow in this definition is that taking the reflexive hull here messes everything up. So if you go to a resolution where the pullback modulo torsion is already reflexive, then you don't have to take the reflexive hull. That's somehow the idea. Okay. And the price you have to pay here is that the resolution depends on m, right? So there you will usually not find one f or one y which works for every m. So to be honest, one should put an m here. Yeah, but I will usually drop it from the notation. But yeah, this is some other issue. And then we can define an approximation of the multiplier ideal, by which still depends on this number m. So by taking im of x cz, taking it to be f lower star or y of, well, this approximate relative canonical divisor minus c times d, where d is okay, so we take the roundup here and we push it down, and d is the pre-image of z, right? The scheme theoretic pre-image of z, which by assumption is a Cartier divisor. Okay, so now we define some kind of multiplier ideal, but this depends on this m, so we need to get rid of this m. And how do you do that? So you show that for any k and m larger than zero, you will always have im of x cz contained in ikm of x cz. Okay, and this means you can define the multiplier ideal itself, so without any m, as the unique maximal element of this family of multiplier ideals depending on m. So, unique maximal element of the set of ideal sheaves im xcz, where m is a natural number. Okay, so this somehow answers your question from before. So maybe the relative canonical divisors do not stabilize, but the multiplier ideals in fact do, right? Because, I mean, essentially in the end, because of Noetherianity, you will have a unique maximal element here, and this is the multiplier ideal. Okay, so next, the next important fact about these multiplier ideals somehow is, also, it's due to Defenné and Haken, that you can always realize any multiplier ideal in the general case. You can somehow reduce to the Q-Gorenstein case, in the sense that you will always find a device on X which makes Kx plus D Q Cartier, and it still gives you the same ideal. But this divisor may depend on this number C. So this is why it's not trivial to reduce everything to the Q-Gorenstein case. But I will come to that later. So okay, so let's define the notion which is needed here. So delta is supposed to be an effective Q y divisor on X, and this is called M compatible. Called M compatible if first of all Kx plus delta is Q Cartier. Q Cartier and you have the following. So Ky plus strict transform of delta minus F fullback Kx plus delta. So I mean the relative log canonical divisor in the usual sense for the pair x delta. If this is equal to the mth limiting approximate relative canonical divisor as I defined it before, for some sufficiently high resolution. Okay, so I'm not being so precise here what exactly I mean by sufficiently high, but I mean there's some more technical definition, but this is essentially the idea. So there are also some more technical conditions which I didn't write out now, but I mean this is the essential part. So let me just write technical conditions. Okay, and now the proposition which somehow tells you that every generalized, I mean every non-Q-Gorenstein multiplier ideal is also a Q-Gorenstein multiplier ideal, is the proposition is the following. So xd is a pair again, and we pick m such that I of xz is equal to im of xz. Okay? Or maybe c times z. And then we pick a compatible boundary. So of course we need to know that these exist, but this will be the statement of the next theorem. By definition you know that I is equal to im for some m, and then you can pick an m compatible boundary, and then you have the following statement: I of x cz is equal to I of x delta cz, where, I mean, the multiplier ideal of x delta cz is somehow, I can write out the definition. I mean, it's like over there, and the point is x plus delta is q cut here, so there's no problem in defining it. So it's basically f lower star of o y of round up k y minus f pullback k x plus delta minus c times the scheme theoretic inverse image of c round up. Okay. And now the point which we the point of the whole definition which we need for this proposition to be somehow useful is of course a statement saying that m compatible boundaries do exist, and this is also due to Defenhain-Haken. So will not give a complete statement, just say m compatible boundaries. So so delta is called a boundary, and m compatible boundaries boundaries do really exist. Okay, and so the proof of this is somehow related to the question whether certain well-divisorial sheaves are globally generated. So the point is once you have a well-divisorial sheaf which is globally generated, then you can construct an M-compatible boundary by looking at a general element of the linear system of this sheaf. So a general global section of the sheaf. And this is a point which you need to consider if you want to prove now theorem 2, or more generally if you think about the discreteness of these jumping numbers. It boils down to a question about well-divisorial sheaves. I will first give the conjecture, which is somehow the important step here, and then show how it can be used to prove discreteness. Okay. So I will now talk about theorem 2, the proof of theorem 2. So the conjecture I'm talking about is due to Urbinati, so he was the first somehow to write it down. So the conjecture is the following. So if X is a normal projective variety and D a Weyl divisor on X, then we would like to find an ample Cartier divisor So an ample divisor H on X such that for all m in n, for all natural numbers m, Ox of m times d plus h is globally generated. Okay, so this somehow looks quite innocuous. I mean, when you see this for the first time, then you think maybe either it is known, or it's either known or easy to prove, or it's wrong. But somehow, and this generality is open, so nobody really knows. I mean, Yeah, so I think it's also an interesting statement in itself, but now I will show how you can use this to prove. So if you knew this, then how would you prove discreteness of jumping numbers? Okay. Also, actually, first, before I show you this, I will give you a special case of this conjecture, which is basically what I did. It's basically this theorem 6, and which will allow us to prove theorem 2. So, which will allow us to talk about discreteness, to prove discreteness of jumping numbers. And I mean, if you replace theorem 6 by conjecture 5, then you get a statement in general without any assumption on isolated singularities or something. Okay, so the statement is this. So again, xd as before. So a well divides on a normal variety. And so I call w the non Q Cartier locus of d. So w is the non Q Cartier locus of d. And then we define u, so an open subset u of x. We define it as the complement of w union the isolated points of w. Okay. And then the statement is there is some ample Cartier divisor H on X such that for all m and n which are sufficiently divisible, well, actually, I believe that this can be proven in the full statement can be proven, so for all m and n, but somehow for the proof, this weaker statement suffices. Therefore, this is all I give in this direction. So there's an ample H such that for all m sufficiently divisible, Ox of m times d plus h is globally generated on u. Okay, and this is of course the main sense in which this is weaker than the conjecture. We have only the Q Cartier points where it's clear anyway, and the isolated points of the non Q Cartier locus. And non isolated points there we cannot say anything. Right. Okay, so now I will tell you how to deduce theorem 2 from theorem 6 essentially. And for simplicity, I will assume that X is projective. So if X is not projective, then well, you cover it by open affine sets, and then you can compactify those, so you reduce to the case that X is projective, in a sense. Except, of course, you lose the property that the non-Q Goldenstein locus of Kx is zero-dimensional. So if you compactify, you don't have that anymore. But somehow, this is not a big deal. You can handle that. Yeah, so for this talk, I will just assume X is projective, then you don't have to worry about that. Okay, so now the question is, do the jumping numbers accumulate? So yeah, we prove it by contradiction. So we assume they do accumulate. So we assume T naught in R is an accumulation point. Accumulation point of Xi. And what this means essentially is TK to the sequence of numbers in Xi, which converges to T naught, and we can also assume that TK is strictly increasing. Right, because I mean the set Xi satisfies DCC, so it cannot be a decreasing sequence. It needs to be an increasing sequence. So what this means is that you have a sequence of multiplier ideals. So you start with I x t1z, and then you have I of x t2z, and so on, and all the inclusions are strict, right? This is what we have. And yeah, how do we show now that this cannot happen? So the goal is to find an ample divisor H, or let's say a line bundle. Find an ample line bundle on X such that all these ideals twisted by L are globally generated, right? So L tensor I of X TK Z is globally generated for all K at least one. And yeah, if we can do this, then of course we are done, because then we just take global sections, and then you get a decreasing sequence of finite dimensional vector spaces. So this stabilizes, and because of the generation assumption, then you will have a contradiction. Right. So how do we find this number, this line bundle L? So first we pick a well divisor, an effective well divisor on X such that Kx minus D is Cartier, okay? So you can always do this, and then you apply theorem 6, which is now hidden. So you apply theorem 6, or if you prefer, theorem conjecture 5 for the general case. You apply this to the sheaf Ox of minus D, right? So you find an H ample and some natural number n, such that Ox of m times H minus D, such that m times H minus D is globally generated for all multiples of m naught, right? And then for such sufficiently divisible m, we define delta m. So this is supposed to be the m-compatible boundary in the end. So we define it to be 1 over m times m, where m is a general section of this sheaf. So a general element of this linear system. Okay. So yeah, now we use basically this theorem, which I did not give in a precise statement, but if you look at the real statement, then you will see that it exactly says that delta M is M compatible. Okay. For this pair XC. Okay, and the point somehow here is that delta M is independent of M in this, I mean, up to Q linear equivalence, right? So delta M is it's just equivalent to H minus D. So let's call this statement star. And yeah, this is exactly the point which we will need to exploit in the proof. So if we did not have this theorem 6, then somehow we could still find an ample h for each m. But I mean, if somehow if h grows faster than linearly, then delta m will not be independent of m. So delta m will be more and more positive, and then the proof breaks down. So this is where we need theorem 6. Okay, next we pick an ample divisor B, so lots of ample divisors around somehow. So we pick B such that Ox of B tensor the ideal sheaf of Z is globally generated. Okay, so I mean this is easy, this is just Serre vanishing somehow, there's no problem here. And then from the statement star, you get that there exists some very ample divisor L such that L minus kx plus delta m plus tkb is big enough for all k. Okay, and for all sufficiently divisible m. Okay, yeah, I mean this is also easy because delta m is independent of m, and tk is increasing, so there's also no problem there. Okay, so then you fix some number n, which is sufficiently large, so it suffices to take and at least dimension of x plus 1. And then you use Nadel vanishing, which is basically a slight generalization of the statement which I gave at the beginning. And when you combine this with Castelnuovo-Mumford regularity, so Castelnuovo-Mumford regularity tells us if you have sufficient vanishing of higher cohomology groups, then you will get at a certain sheaf is globally generated. So so what you get from the combination of Nadel vanishing and Castelnuovo-Mumford is that Ox of n times L tensored by this ideal sheaf x I of x delta m tkz, so this multiplier ideal twisted by this very ample line bundle is globally generated for all sufficiently divisible m and for all k at least 1. Okay. And now we're basically done because, now for any k at least 1, first you can find a number m, I mean by definition you can find a number m such that this chain of multiplier of this approximate multiplier ideal stabilizes at m, and you can always replace this m by a multiple, so you can as well assume that it is sufficiently divisible in this sense, so divisible by m naught, and also sufficiently divisible, and so then we have the following: x of t I of x tkz is equal to im of x tkz, and this in turn is equal to I of x delta m tkz, right? Because delta m is m compatible, and yeah, this means. This means that Ox of NL, of course Ox of NL twisted by I of X TKZ, which is exactly this statement, so it's globally generated. So for all K. And this is, so Ox of NL, this is exactly the L which we require to find in this goal. So by this goal. And yeah, I think that's, I mean, that's a proof, right? So that's how you do it. And yeah, it should be obvious if you have the full conjecture, then you just do exactly the same thing, and then you get discreteness without any assumptions. So you get a positive answer to this question. And yeah, so the real question now, or what I would tell you now if I had time left, was would be how you prove theorem 6, right? So yeah, I don't have any time left for that, but this is essentially the problem that is left here is somehow prove theorem 6 without the assumption, I mean, not only handle the case of isolated points of the bad locus, of the non-Q-Cartier locus, but somehow handle the whole variety. And yeah, so I don't have any time left for that, so I think I'll just stop here. So thank you.